Hey folks, Kevin here. It's a little bit calm today outside, just a small amount of wind, and there's a little bit of noise in the area where we go by the seedlings, the ones that we got started for going out in our annual garden. Today's what, May 23rd, Friday, May 23rd, 2014. And I just wanted to give you, I know I haven't been making too many videos lately. I've been fairly busy with everything here on the homestead. But I wanted to give you a quick run through and show you what's going on. So we'll start off by going in where the seedlings are inside the house and some grow stands we created. Before we had some hardwood cuttings in there. They didn't do great, but they did okay. I'll probably be fairly brief going through. I'll go through the swale system as well, and we'll see just how far I get to go. So without any further ado, I'm gonna grab the camera and we'll take a walk through some wheatgrass we've got up above. As you can see, each one, Thea started all of these planters just the other day. You can see we got a tray of black beans that hasn't come up yet, garbanzo beans, and then we've got quite a few beets, currants, barrage, zucchini, sweet peas, broccoli, cauliflower, lavender down below, so quite a few seedlings, and we've got some more lemon trees down in that area down below there. Some other bush bean sections, some lettuce as well. We got some spinach and romaine started down there, and we've just got quite a few different seedlings started in here, and I think all of our seedlings have been started now. Now we'll go on out into the greenhouse. We'll see some of the ones, a little bit older seedlings that are going to be going in the ground tomorrow. So we got various tomatoes, quite a few tomatoes. We got kidney beans, we got peppers, we got pinto beans, we got some leeks, peppers, some orange seedlings, orange tree seedlings there, some red onions, more tomatoes, sweet potato slips we've started, still getting those going, pinto beans, kidney beans, great northern beans, more pinto beans, another lemon, so amla trees. So that's in here. We've moved our vermicompost systems back outside, and that was our little Harbor Freight greenhouse. We still got covered at this point. We moved our citrus and fig trees, bananas outside. They're doing okay, getting acclimated to the environment. This is last year's pergola, keyhole garden with the strawberries that have been established. These are 1 year old now and they're really flowering up nicely, really beautifully. These keyhole gardens really work out fantastic. These ones I just put in 300. These are ever-bearing strawberries in this section. Then we get to June-bearing over here. And then we've got some alpines that I've had for a year. They produce really small strawberries, but they are great. This will be some of the herbs that are coming out into this area. Different chives, standard chives and garlic chives here. This is where I had started a lot of our trees, like a tree nursery area last year. Worked very well. These are still some of the cuttings. Got some more grapevines. I put in quite a few grapevines already from cuttings. Here we got some mulberry trees started in this area. And some mints. Our turmeric is underneath these planters now. I'm trying to see how well that works in this area. We got some of our flower mixes over here in these seed starting trays. Of course, some avocados, and then kakai pumpkins as well, and just different flower mixes. These are some of the nuts that we've saved in these areas, in these ones. I really like using our milk containers. I use all different size milk containers for plant starters. So these are my wife's creamers, silk almond milk creamers. Work very, very well. Let's see, those are some of the plants that we had over winter that were the kale and chard there. Again, these are the citrus over here. We get out, this is our garden beds we've got to get finished over here, our raised beds. These are handicap ones that I put in originally a couple years ago. And this is where a lot of those seedlings are going to be coming. This is all still in transition and somewhat temporary. We're trying to see how the pattern will work because I'm still doing construction. That'll be another Hugelkultur bed over there. That'll be a terraced one coming off that bank, and a wetland area along the base as well. Over here, I hope it isn't too bad with the wind. Christ. So this is our rain gutter garden bed, and this has worked extremely well. So there's 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20. This is a 20-foot section, 20-foot by 3-foot, and these are just the sand or mortar mixing bins that you'd get at Lowe's or Home Depot. We've been growing various plants in here over the last year and a half, and it's worked out pretty well. But I transplanted a lot of my goji berries. So these are goji berries, and these two. Now these are some volunteers from our previous weather. One of the kales or a lettuce over there, and we got some looks like some collard started here as well. But down here, all these little clusters are the seeds that I started for the goji berries. So there's goji berries in here. We'll just extract the rest out. These are some of the dill that's self-seeded. We'll be putting this out in some of the mounds next to the swales. And then we got some bok choy and some chard started over here. We'll transplant these as well. Everything went to seed. And then over in this area, here's one of the ways we keep track of our weather conditions here. This is a 40-foot trellis area for our indeterminate tomatoes. We'll be using this. This is a new compost that I'm starting this year. It took much longer. I did it over the winter months. This is all citrus fruits from edible arrangements, cardboard, which was really hard. There's a piece of cardboard sitting right there that didn't completely break down. Leaves and rabbit and chicken manure. And that's the same thing that's underneath, each one of these mounds, raised beds that we're going to be planting. Over there with that little tent-like structure, carport there is, there'll be a garden there alongside this side of the building and on the other side in the future. But it's a little bit too much for me to get to this year. And one more spot we'll come to over here. I hope I can figure out how to speed up some of this footage. And this is one of our strawberry beds here. And unfortunately, my weeping cherry, which is a beautiful tree, passed away this last fall. And some of this is another strawberry bed. So we have... I really believe in having redundancy, so I've got several beds of strawberries started at different places on the property. So now we'll take a walk. Jesus, wind is something. I'm going to stop this for a moment and we'll go up to the top and see if it's a little calmer there. Okay, forgot to show you this. This is also right outside the house in the annual garden. This is the kiwi pergola. So currently we have two female kiwis here, hardy kiwis. And these were from Miller Nurseries originally. The two females survived, the male didn't. And that's the replacement that Starkboro took over the Miller Nurseries. And these are the two original Starkboros kiwis, a different hardy kiwi that are self-pollinating. We'll see how they do as well. Okay, we're up here on the top of the property, the highest elevation. There's a corner up there, but that weeping mulberry there. And we have the blue spruce that go along the road. And so around here, and we have, we're at about 450 foot elevation. This is pond one. It has a little peninsula with the weeping willow there. Lots of hardscape work still need to be done, the excavation. I still gotta finish things here. And so our first barrier to the road, we have the blue spruces and the comfrey that I planted in between the spruces last year. So I use this for mulching, really good for the bees, and use it for herbs. I have a dump trailer that I go and I get a whole bunch of this every year. I'll go back again. I've already gotten a second batch, and all along these swales I've planted the comfrey as well for mulching. Catawba trees. All right, so there is a row there. You see the crab apples going down. I don't know how well any of this is showing up, but we'll, as we go down further, it'll be easier to see. This is an area that I actually drive through, one of my access roads coming off at the top of the property. And along here, this is in line with the first mound by the highest swale. And the property slopes going in that direction, but it slopes this way and it slopes that way. And that's how the swales are oriented. So here we have, you'll see flags where all these trees are. And I don't know if you can really see some of these trees. You may just see the flags because I don't mow. We got bird's foot trefoil. That's a honey locust tree there. This is a pecan. These have not leafed out yet. Don't know if that can be seen. A lot of the trees just aren't leafing out yet. And here we come around to our first swale. And as you could see, it curves right around, working with the contour. There's another catawba tree there, so I guess, and there's another honey locust. Over there we have honey locust trees, we have pecans, persimmons, crab apples, honey locusts. On this side of this swale, on this mound, we have pecans, persimmons, honey locusts, walnuts, heart nuts, catawbas, and I just put in each one of these little mounds of horse bedding. Is these are all sections where comfrey has been planted, just so it'll look like this within a couple of months' time. And that goes all the way down. Now there's two elevations to this swale. So this is a higher elevation. And if we go down towards the main driveway down there, someplace in there you'll see that it just drops off and it's another elevation. But these swale systems, they all, many of them interconnect before going over the spillway. These black stakes around here, these are some native plum trees that I transplanted up here. We'll see if they do make it. I've got a lot of pruning to cut back. I got these in late in the fall when the ground was really freezing. And you can see this swale is all interconnected here, and I'm in the middle of it right now. And the swale system, I'll see if I'll show you a section where the swale is right over those Hugelkultur pits. Well, I'll remember when we get down a little bit further. Then a few more of those plums, pecans, persimmons. We also have some currants in this section. What else do we have here? Then I decided to put some, a couple of rolls of garlic up in here. And these are put into some compost right next to a swale. Then we come into another swale mound as we're going down the slope, and we have blueberry bushes, we have gummy berries, and there are blueberry bushes, sorry. That's a blueberry bush that I transplanted from down below. And you can see there's a fair amount of clover that I'd seeded a year ago. And I'm going to be reseeding over the top of a lot of this and bringing a lot of our perennial herbs up here as well. So that's a gummy berry. So we have gummy berries along in here, as well as the honey locust, persimmons, pecans, gummies here, a swarm trap on this tree, a trellis, and I think this is going to be some of our cucumbers and zucchinis up in here. And this will all be developed as time goes on, depending on how well each of the species does. These compost beds with the garlic here, these are all one of my older recipes, using a lot of horse manure and chicken manure, leaves and weeds. And these have worked out very well. And these are blue crop blueberries down here, along in this section here are high bush blueberries that I had transplanted this last fall. And I'll see if I can get up close to one to show you what. So these are the ones I tore out last fall. We used the excavator where these were actually in the woods. Let's see. And I pruned them really heavily over the winter months. And here we got some new blueberry starters starting all around in here. And so those will be like some of the other ones. If we get down and back, I'll show you in a little while. Again, persimmons, pecans. We've got a couple of pawpaws up in here too. This is a horseradish mound I put in here. Now, I've certainly put in horseradish around many of the trees. I'm creating guilds, so there's garlic, horseradish, onions, comfrey around many of our fruit and nut trees. These are some apple trees I got on sale at Tractor Supply, and these are some other blueberry bushes. This is an early season blueberry bush. Which one is this? Duke Northern High Bush Blueberry Bush. And I'm hoping by looking at these ones and seeing all of our volunteer or feral blueberry bushes that the birds have deposited over the years all over the property that I've transplanted. And I've got multiple locations where I've transplanted these blueberry plants. Then as we're getting closer to the road down here, to our driveway rather, right here we got a couple of cables that I've strung up, and you can see these posts. This is a grape trellis, and I've got grape pergolas that I've built as well, but I'm putting grapevines on this I'm going to call it a string trellis, and I've got them on a pergola, and now I'm also starting quite a few of them on some of the trees as well. This is some of the transplants from the raspberry lines that I got out last year, and we didn't get to canning the raspberries until I think it was February. We had them in the freezer all fall and winter, but they're doing okay. These are a red raspberry coming along in here, and up in here more honey locusts, pecans, persimmons. Along in here, another row of blue crop blueberries. I got these at the county soil and water conservation extension. One of the neighbors had some lemon balm, and underneath these mounds here are some lemon balm that's been transplanted. Here I've got four honeyberries. We'll see how these do as well. Four different honeyberry plants. These are from Stark Bros. So we'll see. And again, down in this section, this mound, I haven't gotten the fruit trees in yet, but there'll be more fruit trees in all along here. So we have some blueberry bushes, pecans, persimmons, pawpaw. There are two pawpaws in this area. The walnuts I'm keeping up towards the road in this food forest. Then down along in here, I'm sort of the cardboard king around here. Underneath this mulch is all cardboard, and I just got this in. And there's between 4 and 10 layers of cardboard and paper packaging material, and that's all two companies. My wife's animal hospital, she brings home cardboard just about every day from their supplies that come in, and Edible Arrangements, where I get the fruit from in Syracuse. And these are all our hazelnuts. All of our hazelnut bushes here, or trees, whatever you want to look at them. So that's what's in this section. And we'll walk over here. When I was doing a cutout from a hive in the ceiling of a porch locally, the gentleman had quite a garden selection. And he said, "Do you have a need for any sweet yellow plums?" I said, "Sure." So we went out in his yard and I dug them up, and they seem to be holding so far. I've got one that looks pretty questionable down a ways, but another row of those. And this is another row of predominantly blue crop blueberries as well, going right down. There's some powder blue blueberries. We'll see, those came from last fall. They're looking pretty rough at the Tractor Supply locally. Okay, and another swale, and this is pond two over here, a circular one. The water level's low because my spillway actually gave way. We really had the hardest, coldest, consistently cold, deep frost winter that I can recall in my adult life. And here's another swale system. Those are Saskatoon service berries, those blue flags right there. We have four different, there are some service berries. Let's see if I can. That right there is one of the service berries. So I can't remember the name of that one. I have just two of those service berries, and I've tried to do hardwood cuttings and I haven't been able to get them, but they have a really sweet, delicious taste. And this is our last swale down in this section here, and these are all apple trees along in here, red buds, honey locusts. What else is there? And certainly a lot of comfrey planted in this area as well. I put these other stakes going down here. That my blackberries are down along this retaining wall, and I've taken the tops, put them in the ground, and to try and propagate more blackberries. So these are a thornless triple crown, and the other name is evading my recall at this time, but the. Ultimately, maybe by this next fall, I'll get a second row of blackberries planted here. Didn't have a lot last year because the chickens do get into here and really dig this area up. And this is a spillway right here that unfortunately gave way. So each one of the areas that I've done spillways before, I put this shelf, this marginal shelf around. And we didn't put a marginal shelf here, and that extra mass really a lot, I think, helps with protecting the spillway. So we've just got to go through this and rebuild this section. And there's some of our crooked willows planted around the edges, a couple of pecans that I'm going to move into other areas that aren't doing so well. And we'll stay away from this area up here. Another swarm trap right there. High bush blueberry plants that I just got heavily pruned up in that area. Some of the marginal area. Can't have too much wetland area on your property. So between these systems, each pond system, as they go through the spillways and all, they're picking up nutrients. And in these areas, and not only can they bioremediate some of the toxins that we're putting into our lands around here, they can also serve as a nutritional source for the soil as well. And we'll come down here outside of the annual garden. Oh, across the driveway area we have our sunchokes, another large garden bed. We have high bush cranberries, pecans, walnuts, and heartnuts. I'm sorry, not pecans, but heartnuts and walnuts. Over there are two of the original Hugelkultur beds that I've created. And at the end down there, the chickens just go right into it, little dickens. That pergola, those ones are 2 years old now, and I just transplanted. So there's a grapevine at each one, and I see that grapevine is knocked down, so I've got to string that back up. And this is a grapevine here, and another swarm trap on the other side of that one. So around this margin of this retaining wall for this canal system, and this is a waste management system trying to clean the water, are all of these asparagus plants. I don't know if they're showing up very well. Haven't been able to get out here and harvest them in the last couple of days. But I have some new ones that I just put in amongst the rest. And again, those are chicken spots. Chickens like to, there are little entropy engines breaking things down. Again, in this section, next to the dog, are cherry trees. Lots of cherry trees we got around here. One more crab apple and several cherry trees. Got one that didn't take off. I hope to do at some point in time a nice review of each one of the nurseries and how the bare root trees came, how well they've done over the season and all, so that other homesteaders or permaculture enthusiasts we'll get an idea of some of these. This is pond 3. And we have a woodland area that we can approach over there that has a marginal marsh side. And the island, a family of geese, two geese have their babies here each year. And they go all over the property now. So there's, I think, 5 goslings with them right now. And there's 2 Hugelkultur mounds over there, 2 pergolas here, and our cherry trees in this section. And this is gazebo 1, and we've got more cherry trees up in there, a couple of pawpaws, some aronia plants, bushes. Over here we have some of these yellow flags. It's hard to see when you see all this stuff. These yellow flags here are our service berries, some of the service berries. We've got them in a couple of different places on the property. And sorry about the wind if this is... We got some baby mallard ducks over here. Oh. Sorry about the wind. Alright. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. We may be missing one. I think there were 10 yesterday when I checked. When they get down into this pond I built specifically to help to protect some of the turtles. We have some special concern turtles in this pond. This is a belted kingfisher. Well, anyways, we have the sea berries in this area. Some allium species there. Not too much edible right around the margin of the pond. And here we have some apricot. That's a cherry, sorry. And we have some apricots in here. These are garlic around. So these are some of the garlic and chives that I've salvaged from one site. And I break these up and I put them around as trying to create guilds around each one of the trees. A golden locust, a plum tree, cherry tree, another cherry tree, plum. These are, I'm going to call them plumcots or aplums, you know, apricot plum mixes. There's a couple of them that I got from Bob Wilson Nurseries. I got 6 of them. We'll see how they do. I don't know how cold tolerant they are. Everything's mixed up on the online that I could see. When I say mixed up, I mean that there's some that say that they're hardy to zone 5, and we're zone 5A here. And some say zone 6, zone 7, so we'll see. So English walnut there, another English walnut over there. Several apple species in here. The hive stands, got a couple of places. This is a magnolia. We've got some Canadian hemlock. These are our high bush blueberries transplanted not last fall, but the fall before. And during last winter, I cut them all off. And here they are. They've been doing quite well so far. So I've got a heck of a lot of them, the ones that I've harvested. They just were overgrown. They were within the woods, ultimately. Some more blue crop and Elliot. Blueberries in this area. We have more of the high bush blueberries from our property down in back. We have apples, plums, peaches, some pears. No pears in this section. Get through all this stuff because a lot of this stuff is just chopped and dropped. And I can't remember which these blueberries here are. And we got some peach. Plums, more plums. In this area, here we got some gooseberry, black and red currants in this area. Our red raspberry section in here. Gosh, these red raspberries are delicious. 2 different types of high, service berries over here. I can't remember the names of the 2 types that we have. Here's a comfrey at this point. And see, this stuff is just fantastic stuff. Here we have 4 pear trees here. And a couple of apricots right there and right there. These are last year's hazelnuts that we started. The ones you saw up front are the ones that we started this year. Where the heck is it? There we go. Hazelnuts down in this area here. A pawpaw that didn't make it. We have a couple of the pawpaws that just didn't make it. Down in this area, there's actually a... That's one of the horseradish right there. So there's several horseradish down in this mound of stuff. And here we have three more pear plants in this first row, and gooseberries and a black currant at the end. I've got some horseradish planted on the side, some volunteer melons, whether they're cantaloupe or the honeydew melons, I think is the name of them, the ones that came from edible arrangements, and they're started on the surface of the compost pile. And four Asian pears down here, gooseberries and a black currant. Down, you see the wild mustard plant there with that tree right alongside of it, is an orange quince, two orange quince right there. And actually we'll go over here. It's some of my number two stone I put around the base of each of the hydrants as I put them in, or if I need drainage. This was excess when I was building the greenhouse. Oh, there's our two geese with the goslings. They're really good. They've gotten very comfortable around me. When strangers come around, they get nervous. This was pond one up above the top of the property, way up beyond the buildings, and we went to pond two and went in along the terraced area where the Hugelkultur is being created. And then we went into the canal system, went over to pond three, then pond four, which has the wall around it. And this one goes underground, drains into pond five. And now we're at the west side of the property, and you see all those flags over there. Those are all black locusts that I've started over there. And the little angels, they always, so this, so pond five here has an island in it as well. And this is the one we had to patch last fall. So we'll see how well it does. They've had problems with it for several years. And this is our overflow swale system going down, and it absorbs into the ground. And it's really nutrient rich by this point. And this is all fill that I brought this level of the property up. I don't know if you can appreciate over the edge there. It's about a 4 to 5 foot drop off going to the neighbors there. So I've been building this up over time. So it's a lot of gravel and not such great land. In this area here, I guess we got a couple of choke cherries there. They're out, and some of the elderberries that I've transplanted from a different area. But right here is one of the Hall's Hardy almond trees, and they've done well. I've got three. Sorry. Three that have done very well over the years, and those two that are dead in between are the all-in-one almonds. And this winter was just too darn persistently cold and all. So I've got some more Hall's Hardy almond trees planted around here, and I've just gotten some garlic and some comfrey in here. I did have some chives in there as well, and hopefully this will do well. Hopefully I'll be putting more black locusts along in here, and in a different section of the property I'll be putting in some black walnut. We're not going to go over into the woods. We'll go down next to where it is, but another apple tree here. The high bush blueberries, these are more that I transplanted in the fall. And again, I just chopped these off during the winter months as soon as everything started thawing. And you can see just how well some of the blueberries will come up. The shoots are going to come up. And in 2 years, it'll be pretty good. These cherry bushes really had a hard time. Just about lost this one. Two of them did okay, and one definitely died over there. But I got replaced them with two more that I ended up splitting, and I'll show you down there in a minute. So here we are down in our spillway here. Those are the serviceberry types, the orange and purple plants there. Another plum tree, or blueberry bushes all along in here. couple of Adams, these yellow flags, Adams and John's elderberry bushes. These are the cherry bushes here. Got a few of these blueberries all along in here. And this gets to pond 6, which is our smallest pond, which unfortunately we hit a sand section. So this area just really dumped right out. So I took some of the topsoil that we had left over from up above, which is real rocky, those piles over there. And I started filling in this area to try and seal it up. And it's still leaking, but it's doing okay. Alongside of it is one of those Hugelkultur pits. So that one's about, I think, about 10 feet deep, about 14 foot wide, and I don't know, 70 feet long or so. And a lot of water goes into these Hugelkultur pits. Like I mentioned before, it's just amazing the amount of water in those systems. So we're about 1,000 foot back now. And here are Hugelkultur mounds. Now each one of these Hugelkultur mounds here, these two are both 2 feet down. So, and the logs are put into the lower section. And then I built compost and mulch up over the top. Now these are all plum trees down here and gooseberries, two different types of gooseberries along here. This area where you'd see the rocks here, I'm still trying to build this up some because the water used to come right down here through this area and it would leave our property going downhill over there. So we've made our spillway at that side of the pond 6. And it goes down into pond 7 down there. And I'm building up this area gradually as an access road. So we got another, these purple flags show another type of high bush cranberry, which I'm gonna have to move out of here this fall. I was thinking that these were all bare root and I got so many different trees and bushes in at the same time. I was thinking that I had gooseberries and of course I didn't. And here are several varieties of peach trees along here. And some service berries, these yellow ones. This Hugelkultur mound, this one's 3 foot deep below grade. And it was about 9 foot above grade. And now it's probably 4.5 foot. So, and you'd see some of the logs there. And you'd see strawberries along the top. And there's some goji berries up there as well. And right along this side, I'm going to try. So here I've got some... by that orange flag right there, that's a Chicago hardy fig there. There's a Meyer's lemon here, another Chicago hardy fig. This is a turkey fig. This is one of those plumcots, which is an apricot plum mix. So this is a cotton candy Bob Wilson nursery. They mixed up part of my order and sent me this one instead of the one that I had hoped to get, and this one I think is only hardy to zone 7. But I may be packing leaves around all of these lemons and fig trees over the winter months. But this is an experiment. What can we do to try and get some of these species more hardened off to our climate and see if we can get some, see what we can get as far as fruit production. These, all these yellow flags here are all sea berries as well. More sea berries. And these are Hugelkultur pits. So these ones are both, I can't remember if they're 2 or 3 feet deep, tell you the truth. This one's 6 foot wide, and this one's only 3 foot wide. And of course I haven't cleared off all the stuff on the top yet. This side I did. And this is our blue potato patch right down here because it's pretty thick with compost on top of it as well. They really reduce in volume as they compress over time. And so the water that comes down currently, it actually curves right around this area. It picks up by my compost area over there. Comes around and it was going back feeding up along the Hugelkultur beds, and I'm gradually building this area up before we get down into the trail system and the maple forest. And so this is pond 7 here. And I think I've shown before the big beaver pond down and back, which is quite large, our biggest one on the property. And this has swale systems going both ways, and ultimately this dumps back towards the east on the east side of the property. I'm going to be putting some swales, trying to work through the woodland area, get further east on the property as much as I can, use this water over and over and over again. So, sorry how my voice cut off there. My finger hit the record button by accident. We're back there by pond 7. And sorry, this is, I walked through it. Hopefully the sound isn't too bad with the wind out here today. But I just wanted to show you around some of the things. I know I've been busy construction. I've got to get back to the greenhouse over there and get that started again, the chicken coop greenhouse and the root cellar. I've got to get to work on all of those things, but been working getting all of these berry and fruit and nut trees established, and the supporting species as well. And well, it's really neat, pretty exhausting at times. The winter was really tough on the honeybees, and I probably did miss a few of the plant sections as we went through, but if there's any questions, please don't hesitate to leave a comment or give me a thumbs up. I appreciate it. Until the next video, have a great day. Keep homesteading and grow your own food. Bye-bye.